lecture title, and then today we will talk about how can we see the cross rates. So this was the title last lecture, so we were talking about what are cross rates from the start. So we talk about how and when it was discovered, and also what is the general property of cross rates. But that was really general picture, and then during this lecture series, we will revisit all the issues and details. So for people who didn't come to last lecture, I tried to summarize about what I said. It's not really, I don't know how easily it can be read this once. So briefly, just to summarize last lecture. So the cosmic rays were discovered by Peter Hess in 1912. So this is exactly 99 years since the discovery of cosmic rays. And the property of cosmic rays can be summarized longer than this. But I try to just summarize what I think is interesting. First of all, this is the plots of cosmic ray drawn by Simon Sorge. And it shows the plot which is continuous over a really wide range of energy. So that's interesting from the start because it's very smooth. Of course, there's some characteristic kink which when the plot changes. So we will talk about the later part in the lecture. And also, this is all particle flux. So there's different kind of favor inside the cosmic ray. Most of them are photon, and it changes with energy. But we know that 1 GeV, which is around this beginning part of the flux, about 85% is photon, and 12% is helium. And there's numerous different kinds of heavy nuclei, lithium, beryllium, carbon, oxygen, hydrogen, all these elements we know that is existing in the Earth. And also, we have 2% of electron. But again, this composition is changing with energy, so there's some part which was not measured yet, and we want to know what is that information and how they can connect to the universe or our understanding about the universe. And also about the directional information. So because of the cosmic ray, by definition, is charged particle originated in outer space and that reached to the Earth. So it is the point here is charged particle. So it cannot go straight in the magnetic field, and our environment is really filled with all the magnetic field. The Earth is filled with, surrounded by magnetic field, and solar system itself is surrounded by magnetic field, and the galaxy itself is also having a magnetic field. So cosmic ray cannot directly come to us. Because of that, the work of cosmic ray is isotropic, meaning that even if you see this direction and you see the other direction, the information that you will get from this completely opposite direction will be the same. But again, there was new recent measurement in a GeV energy range, and they found it around this energy range also at the, I'm sorry, it's TP energy range, so around this middle part. And they found some anisotropic, so they found some difference between this direction and some the other direction. But the difference in here is less than 0.5%. So we may also want to know why it happens and what and whether that is the only anisotropy that we will measure. And another thing is if it was really, really, really high energy cosmic rays around this much, even human cannot generate this much of high energy. And in that case, because the cosmic ray itself is high enough, so it will bend much less inside the geomagnetic field. So maybe it can give us the directional information about where it came from, which will give us information what kind of object or what kind of mechanism in the universe which can generate this much high energy particle, which will be also interesting. So that was summary of last lecture. And this lecture we will talk about how can we see the cosmic rays. Usually we will not use the word see because we cannot see. That's even now we are bombarded by cosmic rays, but we cannot see it, right? So usually we will use measure, but I kind of wanted to use the word see because that's more direct, I think, or my biased idea about English think that it's better and friendly tongue than measure. So first of all, we will talk about the interaction of charged particle because that will give us clue how we can see the cosmic rays. That can be a little bit boring, but this part is really interesting. Not only because it will give us a clue how we can see the cosmic ray, but also because we need to understand all this kind of interaction to understand what we can measure. Because the earth itself is a lot of material inside. So what we measure in the ground will be different from what we measure at the top of atmosphere, because there's a lot of material between the layer. And also, what we can measure at the top of atmosphere will be different from what we actually expect from the original size of cosmic ray, because it needs to travel a long, long way, and then we will need a lot of material during this travel. So we want to know what kind of thing that it will need, and what kind of interaction that it will need, that kind of stuff. So that's why the interaction of charged particle with matter can be very interesting, and we need to know all the details about that. And also after that, we will try to talk about what is the good plan if you want to hunt some cosmic rays. Like, depends on what kind of cosmic ray information that you want to get. You need to decide where to put your detector, how to design your detector. So we will talk a little bit about that. And then I will go and jump into the detector part. So I will give some summary, really brief summarize about examples of cosmic ray detector from the very beginning of history, when we just used this electroscope and up to current recent really sophisticated detector, and try to follow and try to connect the first part of interaction to the last part of detection. So that is the general idea about this lecture. Alright, so there is a lot of interaction for the charged particle, and there's also different kind of interaction for neutron particle, like photons, like light. Light can react differently with the charged particle, and also this kind of interaction changes with the energy of charged particle or energies of photons. But in here, I will try to focus mainly on the charged particle, because that's what cosmic rays are. But again, the interaction of this particle is connected to each other, so some of the time you actually need to know what the photon will react. But I will just mention about the charged particle for this lecture, and for the photons interaction, I will maybe mention in next lecture, I think. So from the start, there's a Coulomb scattering, ionization laws, and Cherenkov light, and Bramson law. This is all the interactions that you would expect the cosmic ray would go through when it meets matter. But also, there's another interaction with some special conditions. For example, if there's a magnetic field, there will be an additional interaction that you would expect. And also, if the matter changes from one material to the other material, there's another interaction comes in, and that kind of stuff. So I will go through these things, and it's not too boring. All right. First of all, the Coulomb scattering. So again, the cosmic rays are charged particles. And inside all the material, which looks very solid, like this desk, is actually made out of the atoms and molecules and that sort of stuff. So that meaning that it's like a lot of nucleus are inside this material. And also the electron, which is surrounding the nucleus. That's why everything in here that we can see is neutral. They don't have charge. But the cosmic rays and the high energy particles are energetic enough to be able to go through the material. In that case, you need to think about what kind of interaction can happen between this charged particle and an atom and electrons inside this material. So first of all, because they are electrically charged, so it will feel the force between. So for example, if there's a plus and the other plus is meeting, then they will try to reverse. And if there's a plus and if there's a minus, then they will try to attract each other. So first of all, this one was discovered by Rutherford, and he tried around this time, I cannot remember exactly when it was discovered, but around early 1900, I think. People didn't have an idea about what the nucleus would look like. They didn't know whether it's a super plus charge and minus charge, or whether it has a more compact plus charge at the center and surrounding the electron, which we know right now. We know what is the structure would look like. But around that time, people didn't have any idea, any clear idea how the nucleus would look like. So a lot of folks did this experiment. So what they did was, there's a foil board, very, very thin foil board, which will be a collection of both nuclei. And he shoots the alpha particle. And alpha particle is a helium nucleus. What he found was that sometimes the alpha particle, actually most of the time, the alpha particle goes through a foil like it cannot see foil at all. So it will just go through without any kind of interaction. But sometime he found out that the trajectory of alpha particle is bending, like this kind of stuff. And also very, very small chance, there's a chance that alpha particle will be just returning to him. He shoot the alpha particle in that direction, and he found the alpha particle is returning to him. So because of that, because a lot of them are just passing through without that kind of dramatic interaction, he concluded that in the nucleus there is really small, tiny, compact part of the each atoms, which and it's kind of collected in a really, really small area. Because if it is in a large area, you would expect that a lot of things will be bending or returning to him, but which that didn't happen. So he concluded that there is a small compact part inside the atom, and that's nucleus. So it is the scattering is when the charged particle or cosmic ray go into the material and it will bend like this because of this force between the charged particle and nucleus inside the material. And we call this elastic scattering because it doesn't change the energy of cosmic ray, it just changes the direction. That's why we call this elastic scattering. And the deflection angle, how much it will deflect, it depends on the atomic number of the injection particle, like cosmic ray, whether it's a proton or whether it's a helium, will change the angle, average angle. And also it depends on the atomic number of the target. So if target is much heavier, then it will bend more, average. And also it depends on the energy of injected particle. For example, if the energy of injection particle is really high, then it tends to less bend. It's same with the charged particle will bend less in magnetic field if it has higher energy. So that is the complementary thing. Interaction. And there is another thing which is also, actually this is the main part of the charged particle interaction with the material. We call it ionization loss because this is energy loss of the charged particle inside the matter by exciting and ionizing atoms of the matter. That's why it is called as ionization loss. So ionization is the process which convert the atom or molecular into an ion by adding or removing charged particles, just by definition. So what happens is when charged particles go through matter, material or matter and inside matter, so there will be a lot of molecular and atoms inside the matter, and then they will have some kind of interaction, the electromagnetic interaction, which I just expressed as just lines there. And that will give energy and exciting the electron of some atom. So the electron in this atom will get some energy from this cosmic ray or charged particle, and that will go excited level, which is higher level than the ground level, which is the absolute minimum of energy level that atom can be. And or it can be excited enough so it can, the electron gets enough energy so it can actually be moved from the atom. In that case, the electron will go out and this atom will not be no longer neutral, but it will have a plus charge. So that's actually ionization, and this is example of excitation. So by inducing this kind of change in matter, this injected particle, charged particle, the original particle, will lose its energy. So that's what we call as ionization loss. And low energy particle, if the energy of this injected particle is relatively low, then that will lose more energy compared to higher energy particle, just because it will have more time to interact with atoms in the medium. For example, if the charged particle is really fast, then it will not have enough time to make this kind of interaction with atoms inside the matter, so that's, it will lose less energy compared to low energy particle. And also, because it's, again, electromagnetic force, if the injected particle is more charged, for example, if it is helium, then compared to proton, it will lose more energy. And also, it depends on the atomic number of the matter as well. So that was ionization loss, and then we will talk about Cherenkov light, which will be maybe the only part we may have a chance to actually see with our eye. So it is the light emitted when a charged particle move inside the matter with a velocity faster than the velocity of light. And you would question that, oh no, 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 I know the light, velocity of light is the fastest thing which can exist in the world, which is right, just when the matter is vacuum. So the light of, velocity of light in the vacuum is the fastest velocity can which can exist, but inside the matter, the velocity of light actually is much slower compared to the velocity of vacuum. So if the charged particles' energy is high enough, then it actually can travel faster than the velocity of light inside the matter. So for example, inside the water, the velocity of light is much slower, like 75, 78, or 80% of the velocity of the velocity of light inside the vacuum. So this is the interaction that will happen when the charged particle moves faster than the velocity of light inside the matter. So what will happen is there will be some light coming out from this interaction, and eventually it will make cone shape of light. And this is named after Chernkov. There's a humorous way of writing this interaction. I just choose this one. So again, this one, how much energy the charged injected particle will lose is also depends on how highly charged the particle is. So for example, compare the single charged particle like photon nuclei. The helium nuclei will lose more energy by this interaction, and also it will emit more Cherenkov light. So that's Cherenkov light. Not bored yet? Alright, so because we are bored. Alright, I think we are almost at the middle. So next thing that we will think about is Raumsalam. So there is German sitting there, so I need to be careful about the pronunciation, which I'm quite sure that I'm already wrong. So Raumsalam is the radiation associated with the deceleration of electrons in the electromagnetic field of nuclei of atoms. What happened is that, so the nuclei itself actually is much smaller than this one because it's just for our convenience. So there, in the atom, there will be nucleus at the center, and there will be a lot of electrons around the nucleus. Depending on how many of the electrons will be there, it depends on how heavy the nucleus is. What happened is if the injection, this Raumsalam interaction is just dedicated for the electron, because electron is really, it's point-like, we cannot measure the size of electron because it's really, really, really tiny. And because it's really, really small, we can actually go through and then penetrate the atom like that, and it can actually feel the electromagnetic field by this nucleus. And because of that electromagnetic field, again, this is magnetic field, so the electron will bend its direction. And because of this kind of bending, it will lose its energy, and the amount of, not exactly, almost, or can, well, depends on the situation, but it can lose almost all of its energy by this deceleration, and that energy loss is emitted by light. So that light we call as a Raumsalam photon. And I still don't know how to pronounce, but Raumsalam is German, and Raum is to break, and then Sauron, okay, you can correct me later, is radiation. So it's, yes?
Is the deceleration essentially an example of a type of a Coulomb force on the particle in this instance? In other words, is the reason for Raumsalam essentially at a fundamental level because of the Coulomb force?
Yes. But one difference is between Coulomb scattering and this one is changing the energy of the injected particle. So that's slightly different in a way. But it's essentially, yes, it's just essentially electromagnetic field. So electromagnetic field.
Since the Coulomb force is electric,
yes.
Where does the magnetic part come in?
Because of the nucleus has a charge.
So there's a magnetic
yes.
force too.
Yes. But yeah, in some way. So if you translate directly from here, then it's a breaking radiation. So by breaking, stopping the particle, it is emitting the radiation. That's Raumsalam photon. And also, this energy loss due to the Raumsalam radiation, Maybe I'm wrong. I think it's better electromagnetic, but magnetic field is maybe wrong. It's just a force between one charge particle to the other charge particle. And deceleration is due to this electronics, electrostatic force than magnetic field. I'm sorry. So, also this energy loss due to this Raoul-Thompson radiation is depending on the atomic mass and the charge number of target material as well. Alright, so that was all the interaction that you would imagine which will generally happen when charged particles come into the medium. But and then, as I told you before, there's interaction which happens with just a special condition. So first of all, there is a synchrotron radiation. So that's radiation when there is magnetic field. So when charged particle moves inside the magnetic field, it loses its energy to synchrotron radiation. So this is actually magnetic field related thing. So in high energy, so I think inside the geomagnetic field, if the electron's energy is 10 to the 9 electron volt, then you would imagine X-ray radiation is coming out by this interaction. And there's a transition radiation. That's when charged particle go through two different kind of material, then it can feel the difference in material. So because of that, it emits some kind of radiation that we call as transition radiation because it emitted when there's a transition of material. So that's kind of special thing. And another thing is, another interaction that you would imagine to happen is inverse Compton scattering. I kind of feel awkward because I didn't explain about Compton scattering, but I just jumped into inverse Compton scattering. But we will talk about Compton scattering for later part. So that's when electron meets the photon. So when electron meets photon of low energy, then it will lose its energy and it will give its energy to the photon. So the photon itself will gain more energy and go through its way. So that's when an electron interacts with the photon with some photons, and that's when it happens. I think it's more interesting later on part when we talk about the extra side of quantum wave isolation with this interaction. And there's annihilation, so that's when particle meets its anti-particle and actually contains the word nihil, which is nothing. So what happens is when positron, which is anti-particle of electron, meets electron, then it will disappear, both of them will disappear, and just two gamma will remain. Just like this. So electron and positron meet each other, and then the two gamma will be generated by that interaction. So this is just an example of positron and electron, but any other kind of antimatter and matter interaction, you can imagine this annihilation is happening. So that was another interaction. And this is the last slide, I promise, about interaction. So there's another thing which I would categorize as a decay. There's two different kinds of decay. One is particle decay and one is radioactive decay. Maybe you are more familiar with this radioactive decay. So particle decay is when elementary particle transform into other elementary kind of particle. It's maybe a little, I really wanted to put this interaction because that way it acts some important function later on. So again, I apologize that I didn't really explain all pi zero and pi plus minus. That's elementary particle actually is imagined made out of two quarks. So by itself, it can be neutral or it can have a charge. And by it, some of them, for example, this pi zero, pi plus minus is really, really, by itself, it's kind of tend to change to other particles. So the mean lifetime is about this much. So 10 to the 17 second. So when you have pi plus, then after this lifetime, you would expect that will decay to other particle. That also I can explain, but muon and muon paper, the neutrino. So this means 99% of time after this mean lifetime, the pi plus will decay to this different kind of elementary particle. And with this small chance, it can actually decay to the positron. I just wanted to put this number because it's very impressively accurate number. So meaning that there was some physicist plus PhD student working in the accelerator, counting how many events they are seeing and try to come up with the ratio between this branch and the other branch. That's why we have this accurate number. And also pi zero is decaying to two gammas. There's a really small chance that it can decay to the other branch. So like this. So after this mean lifetime, it switches longer than pi plus, but still it's microsecond level. So pi zero will decay to two gamma in like less than microsecond. So that's particle decay. And then radioactive decay is when the atomic nucleus of an unstable atom loses energy by emitting the ionization particle. So for example, this uranium will decay to thorium plus alpha. Again, alpha is a helium nuclei, so what can happen is actually you can Google it or find it in the Wikipedia. So we have really nice chart of the atomic table which will give you in different kind of axis. One axis is atomic number and then the other axis is neutron number. So when the parent particle is unstable, then you want to be somehow you want to be stabilized by itself. So you try to stabilize by itself by emitting different kind of particle, and some of the particle can be beta, which is electron, beta plus, which is positron, or alpha. And depends on what kind of ionization particle it emits, it actually changes changes to the other particle, the other atom. So how it changes depends on what kind of particle you emit. So that's radioactive decay, and this is happening a lot in nature. So even in this concrete or earth, there's always some amount of the unstable particle, and that way emit this kind of ionization particle. And that's why we know that there is some amount of radioactivity is existing in the Earth, even without cosmic rays. Right, so that was the introduction part, and then let's review what we learned up to now. So let's follow some charged particle. Here, I just put some low energy charged particle on the top, and there's two material. One material is slightly less dense than, or much less dense than the other material, meaning that there will be less atom and nuclei in this material compared to the other material. So when charged particles come into the metal, what will happen is because of the Coulomb scattering, you will scatter around, so you will not be able to go penetrating the material because the particle itself is low energy, so it cannot penetrate. And during the time, it will ionize the atom on the material because ionization laws that we talk about. And of course, it is ionizing the atom around its wavelength. But because there's more electron around the material, there's a lot of electron inside the material. So this positive signal will be just get another electron of the material, and it will be neutralized again. So we will not be able to feel it if you don't have any kind of special setting to actually feel it. It's really hard to say this feeling slow. But what happens is when you put the charged particle in more dense material, then it cannot go through this long trajectory because it will need more atoms in this material because it's much dense. So there will be more atoms inside this material. So that's why it cannot penetrate as much as this particle could go. But again, with ionization on, yes.
Are you talking about charged particles with masses equivalent to an alpha particle, or less than, or any?
Any.
Any?
Yes.
All right, thank you.
So in here, this simple example, we just saw the interaction mostly due to Coulomb scattering and ionization loss. And then eventually what we want to do is we want to know what cosmic rays interact with matter or interact with the Earth, actually. So when it comes to the Earth, it will be, first of all, in the space, which is solar system, and also it will meet the atmosphere of the Earth, and it will go through the Earth and then see the atmosphere again and then go back to space. But most of cosmic rays actually, except the neutrino, all the cosmic rays cannot really go through this this kind of change of the material, because it will lose all the cosmic ray will lose its energy in atmosphere. We will talk a little bit more details about that. Before I jump into the cosmic rays interaction in our atmosphere, I need to introduce one more process, the last process that we need to understand. Because cosmic ray is composed, most of composition of cosmic ray is a proton. And proton is slightly different, especially when it is a high energy. It cannot really just penetrate the material and then go through all the interaction. Interaction that we talk about. So, because when the instant particle is really, really high energy particle, then it kind of have a lot of chance that it will actually directly hit the nucleus. And because of that, there will be a lot of different kind of secondary particle will be generated in a collision. So the secondary particle is particle which can generate by this kind of interaction. So for example, if the gamma is produced by whatever process that we talk about, like Brown Salon, we call that as secondary particle, just to make a difference between the primary particle which is just injected to the matter, to the whatever byproduct is. So that's secondary particle. So what happens is when high energy photon comes into the nucleus, then you will actually have a great chance, especially if it is really, really high energetic particle, it will hit the nucleus itself and break down the nucleus. And that will make a lot of other interaction because a breakdown nucleus will have electron and proton and neutron inside that nucleus. And that will go through all the other interaction that we talk about. For example, when the high energy photon hit the nucleus and make another proton inside this interaction, then that proton will have an energetic enough and that will hit another proton inside the nucleus because nucleus is a lot of nucleus and neutron inside one nucleus. So because of that, there will be chain of reaction happens. And you would imagine the light nucleus from this big nucleus will have enough energy so it will jump out of that mother body, and also the other light nucleus can happen. And the neutron from the nucleus will be able to escape from the force which was collecting all these different kind of vapor inside one nucleus. And that will happen like again and again. So. And also the resulting nucleus after this whole bombard of collision is not guaranteed to be stable. So when it's not unstable, then it will decay to other atoms to try to stabilize themselves. And during this process, it will emit another radiation. And this kind of light nucleus can gain a lot of energy by the energy of the primary proton, and it can hit another nucleus, it meets another nucleus, then do the kind of similar stuff that it did to this mother nucleus. So this is the interaction that we need to think about, because that's what will happen when cosmic ray hits the atmosphere. So first, let's start with electron, because that's most simpler. So when electron comes to the atmosphere, then it will go through the Brown Salon process. So it will lose its energy because of the nucleus. Inside the nucleus, it will bend and decelerate, and then it will lose its energy, and it will emit the Brown Salon photon. But have, yes?
I meant to ask this previously that you passed on to Rita. Electrons of this sort can be captured by certain nuclei.
Yes.
How does that affect the brain spiral? How does it affect it?
It depends on the energy of the electron. But electron, if energy is really, really high, then it's really hard to capture that electron from the neutron. So what happens is if energy of electron becomes really, really small, then it can, the speed will be really slow. In that case, it can be captured by other neutron particles.
Does it give off this radiation on those circumstances?
No. Yeah, it can. Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, it can give off the radiation, but because of this process is different from the Brown Salon, we call different name for that process, which I didn't explain. Yes. So because of this Brown Salon, and then if the energy of this electron is really high, then you can imagine that the energy will be divided by, if not half, half, but it will, a lot of energy can go to this Brown Salon photon. then this photon is energetic enough and go through the process that I didn't explain. So it will actually generate positron and electron. Actually, you can think this as inverse interaction of annihilation that we talk about. So, and the other electron, if it is high energetic enough, even after this loss of its energy, then it can meet another nucleus and generate another ground solid. So it will lose a little bit of its energy again, but it will emit another ground solid. So this kind of chain reaction can happen again and again like this. And positron itself can also generate the ground solid because positron is actually exactly the same with electron except the charge. Just charge particle is different. So it can, the mass is the same, and the size is the same, so it can generate ground solid as electrons generate the ground solid. So this kind of chain reaction can go like continuously until all these particles lose its energy enough that it cannot generate new particles. Which I'm too lazy to draw all these things, so I just assume that there's like a bunch of tens of thousands of interactions from one stage to the other stage. But eventually what will happen is all these particles lose its energy enough that it cannot really create the charge, create the ground solid radiation. In that case, what will happen is positron will annihilate to the two different kind of gammas that as we talk about, that's annihilation. And in electron's case, now it cannot lose its energy by ground solid because it doesn't have enough energy to create another gammas. So instead of that, it will lose its energy by ionization laws that we talk about and maybe scatter around, and eventually it will lose all of its energy and disappear. So this is chain of interaction that will happen when electron comes into the Earth and meets the atmosphere. And again, you can imagine same kind of, a little bit different, but almost same kind of interaction will happen when positron comes into the atmosphere. And we call it as electromagnetic shower. And another thing that happened is, as this electron is high energetic enough to create all these secondary particles, then that means it's likely that it will travel much faster than the speed of light inside the atmosphere. So because of that, it will emit a chunk of light, as we talked about that before. And also, it will excite the nitrogen atom, actually excite all the atoms in the atmosphere, and especially nitrogen, when nitrogen is excited, and when it goes to ground stage again, because it wants to be stabilized again, then it will emit some kind of light that we call it scintillation light. So there's this chain of interaction that happens when electrons come into atmosphere. And the next question is, what will happen if photon comes into atmosphere? And again, because I'm lazy, I could not really draw every single picture like electron because it's more messier. So when photon comes to the atmosphere, then first of all, what will happen is the nuclear interaction that I talked before. So imagine this is proton and this is unfortunately nitrogen or oxygen atom in the atmosphere. Then it will break down, nitrogen will break down and lose some part of its nucleus, and it will not no longer be nitrogen because it already lost quite a lot of nucleus. So then the chain of reaction again can happen. So during that interaction, what can happen is a lot of time there will be pi plus and pi minus and pi zero will create it because of that nuclear interaction that I mentioned. And the whatever nucleus it is can separate, break down in smaller part, and the smaller part will go through almost a picture, which is just a kind of drawing the line here. And the pi zero will, as we talk about, decay to the gammas. But the thing is, if the initial energy of primary positron ray is really high enough, then these gammas will be high enough. So it can generate electron-positron pair like it did in this interaction. And again, if it is still energetic enough, then it will make actually another bunch of electromagnetic magnetic shower that we just mentioned about and go through until it loses all of its energy. And chi plus minus will decay to other kind of favor of elementary particle and go through its own kind of chain of interaction. So, and also because the charged particle is high energy enough, so it can actually generate this Cherenkov light as we talk about, and also scintillation light as electron indeed. So that kind of thing will happen. And most of the cosmic wave will lose completely of all of its energy by this chain of interaction. That's why we can survive in the ground, because it will lose, even the highest energy of cosmic wave will lose all of its energy when it goes to, comes to the ground. So that we call as air shower, because of these particles are energetic enough, so it has momentum which all of these, even the secondary particles, want to go in the same direction as primary particle did. So this is one of the examples, I don't know whether you can see it or not. That's better? Right. So in here, this is actually simulated data, because we know all these processes. Actually, by using all our knowledge, we can simulate and try to see what would actually happen. And so this is the result of simulation. It's not really great. If you go to the Adela, you can see a better version of this one. So all this final line here is all this charged particle. And the chain of the interaction will happen until the secondary particle loses all of its energy. And the next question is that, so that was all the interaction the cosmic wave will need when it comes into the atmosphere. Then the next question is, so what? What do we need to think about? So that comes to the plan of the cosmic wave hunting. First of all, you need to think about what do you want to measure. Because, for example, we have really, really wide energy range of cosmic ray, and there's still a lot of things that we want to measure and we need to measure. And depends on the energy range and depends on the thing that you want to measure, you need to decide very carefully. For example, if you want to measure the composition of cosmic ray, how much of cosmic ray is photon, how much of cosmic ray is ion, then you should already know that you cannot measure it on the ground. Because it will go through all this interaction, and the only thing that you can measure on the ground is secondary particle. So there's a way that you can measure, but you cannot directly measure what kind of particle you just saw, whether it's a proton or ion. One kind of trick that you can do is because you can declare that you know all these details of interaction, so you can reconstruct the shower and you can see the difference between proton and ion, but that's rather indirect. So if you are really interested about the composition, then you want to go to the top of atmosphere, so measure the direct information of the cosmic ray before it interacts with atmosphere. Then you need to think about how common that particle is. For example, if you want to measure the particle around the knee, around this energy, that's just one particle per square meter per year. So, and you know that you cannot build kilometer, square kilometer area in the space to measure the particle. It's just way too big. There's no spacecraft which can deliver your detector to top of atmosphere. It will cost a lot. The mass will be enormous. So it's just impossible. So you need to think about what kind of cosmic ray you want to measure. So generally what we have, what is going on in our field is that for the composition measurement, we usually go to the top of atmosphere for low energy range because we can. But as energy goes higher and higher, because the cosmic ray become rarer and rarer, we tend to build our detector in the ground. And even when you build your detectors on the ground, you need to think about what kind of energy that you want to measure. Because if you really want to aim for this, the last highest energy of particle, then you need one to make really, really, really good detector. But if you are more interested about kind of in the middle of here, then you want to go a little bit higher place and maybe make a smaller but more dense array of detector to measure more information from the air shower. So that was the strategy of cosmic ray hunting. So hopefully it's a help or if you want to hunt some cosmic rays. And so, just talking about seeing or measuring some invisible quantity because our eyes cannot see. Maybe we can see some Cherenkov, maybe we can see some light coming from the interaction, but again, we just cannot see bulk of the quantum wave because that quantum wave will lose a lot of its energy by ionization loss, and our eye cannot detect that. But quantum waves are not just the only thing that we cannot see, because, for example, we cannot see the temperature, and we cannot see the wind direction or the strength. We can feel it, but we cannot see that. And how can we measure or see this invisible quantity of things? Then we use some instrument to help us to see what's going on there. For example, for the temperature, we can use temperature thermometer to see what is temperature right now, right? So that's actually using the expansion of alcohol. Actually, alcohol itself does not have a color, so we even add the color for us to be more easily to see the change. So because the alcohol will expand when temperature goes higher, so we can actually see this thermometer and it's check what is the temperature right now, which I will read as 20 degrees Celsius and you will read as 70 Fahrenheit. So we can do the same for the charged particle like quantum rays. Then we need to think about what kind of signal that we can get from the quantum rather than what kind of thing that we can see about the quantum ray. And that depends on the interaction of quantum ray in the matter. So we know about the interaction of quantum ray in the matter is, first of all, it will bend inside the magnetic field because it's charged particle, and it will ionize the atom inside the matter. So by using this interaction, we can actually detect the quantum waves. So first of all, now we will talk about the detector. I just have 10 minutes or so I will try to not speed up. So electroscope. So when the Hess discovered the quantum wave at the first time in 1912, this is the exact detector that he used to detect the quantum wave. This looks like this, and there's a lot of variety of versions. Some of that look like ground, some of that look like a ball, but this is just whatever image that I got from the Google. So what happened is, this is the way you can charge this electroscope. So this one is all the leaves in here, so it will just stay as it is if there's nothing happen. And what will happen is when you put and close the charge material around this area, that it can actually induce some charge inside this electroscope. And because it's a plus charge, it will attract more minus charge around this ball. And because the minus charge is attracted to that ball, these all the leaves will be charged as plus. But the thing is, this is all the leaves is actually two things, and if that two part is charged by plus, and if plus and plus is nearby, then we try to encourage each other. So actually, we will be separated by each showing here, like V-shape. And when you ground this part, what will happen is the electron will be moved and then travel to the ground. And if you remove this ground line and then remove this charged particle, then because this whole system will be more charged as a plus because you remove the electron by grounding, then it will be, even without doing anything else, it will be charged by plus, and it will separate it like this shape. So that is the initial condition of this electroscope when it is charged. Then if there's nothing happen, you would expect, if it is isolated completely from the outside of the system, you would imagine that it will stay as it is like forever. But unfortunately or fortunately, there's a quantum wave. And because a quantum wave will lose its energy inside this material and inside this this electroscope, then it will ionize around the material around here, and that will make some leakage between this plus charge excess to the system. So it will slightly lose its plus charge by leakage like that. And because it's now less charged with the plus, it will slowly closing by, and eventually it will stay calm at like this in parallel. So by measuring the rate of leaks, actually you can see here they have some kind of norm that you can actually see how much it is separating each other, like several angles. And if you have a timer, then you can actually measure how fast this is closing. So that's how Victor has could measure the ionization rate. So say, look 5 minutes, you say this one has been reduced from 5 degrees to the 4 degrees, then you can actually write down the number, and you can say, okay, it decreased from 5 degrees to 4 degrees in like 1 minute. And he measured this rate as he goes to a higher altitude by using the balloon, and that's how he determined that there is ionization radiation coming from the universe. And it's not only just cosmic ray, and it's also whatever radioactivity is around this electroscope, you can actually measure the intensity of the radioactivity by look at this closing rate of the leaves. So that is the early detector that we use to measure the charged particle, actually. But one thing here, you notice, yes?
What does the adjustment not alter?
This one is
no, on the side.
Which one?
The side of the instrument.
This one.
What does it change, and what?
Yeah, for this one, I'm not really sure. I kind of can imagine that maybe it's wrong, but I'm not really sure about this picture. Yeah, I will try to find out and tell you later. Okay. But the thing about this electroscope is you cannot say whether it's hot, you know, plus charge or helium nucleus was going through this one, and you cannot say which direction. You cannot say whether it is going through this direction or that direction. The only thing that you can say is how many of them go through this instrument. And you want to know a little more, so that's when a new detector was discovered or invented, and the name of this one is Cloud Chamber. And there is a lot of nice movies you can find on YouTube. So the cloud chamber is you put some kind of vapor, like water vapor or alcohol vapor. And when there's enough of vapor inside this confined area, then it's almost about to, you know, make a, it's overly saturated. So when there's a chance, then it actually can make a vapor by itself. So what will happen is you just make that oversaturated situation, and when cosmic ray or any charged particle goes through this oversaturated air, then it will ionize, as we say, around the material, around the cosmic ray, and that will create the ion. And the other vapor, and then that will eventually make a kind of vaporized state. Hard to explain. So it will actually make some kind of trace because it will become, it's almost the same as why rain is dropping, right? So it is kind of attracting the other molecule around them because it's already charged because of cosmic ray. And because it's already overly saturated, it will make a water by itself, for example. And then as cosmic rays go through the, and make that, go through this material, it will actually make the trace of its trajectory. And if you have a camera, and you can take a picture of that, and you can go say that which direction the cosmic ray went through, and you can actually see the movie and movie may tell and explain better than what I did. I don't know whether you can actually see this or not. But there's like this kind of trace is happening because of the charged particle go through this cloud chamber, this kind of thing. It was not there. But because there's something goes through this cloud chamber and make that kind of trace, you can actually see the trajectory of cosmic rays. So maybe this is the closest example of how you can see the cosmic ray. You actually can see where the cosmic ray hits and interact with the material and go through and follow this direction. So that's kind of neat, and actually it's very easy to make, so you can actually make that in your house if you're interested. So that was the example. And furthermore, if you can induce a magnetic field around this chamber, and you can actually change the trajectory of cosmic ray, because cosmic ray is charged particles, so if you have a magnetic field, then you will bend inside the magnetic field. So by changing the magnetic field, you can actually control the trajectory of cosmic ray inside this cloud chamber, and you can actually see the change by whatever change you made in the magnetic field. So that was the kind of second generation of detector, and then he used for the discovery of positron and muon and kaon and lambda and their kind of elementary particles. I'm just giving you, so all of these are actually based on the ionization laws. So it will lose, it will try to ionization the material inside that detector, and we can actually try to make a signal out of that kind of energy loss of the constant rate. And this is also kind of similar to it. And you can stack the immersion chamber. It's actually the same with the photograph. So when charged particle go through this immersion chamber, it will ionization the material, and it will leave some kind of trace. And then after you develop this immersion chamber, you can get a nice image of with measurement image like this one. So this one is when photon hits the whatever nucleus inside the immersion, and it will make the nuclear interaction that we talk about. So a lot of secondary particle go through, and that secondary particle actually make another interaction with the nucleus inside the immersion chamber and go through the chain of interaction that we talk about. So that's all the trace that left in the immersion chamber. And physicists can actually look back and look at the film and try to make sense out of this mess and try to come up with the interaction and try to learn about the physics and what kind of constant rate that we measure. And also, if you can actually control the time of your immersion chamber, you can actually calculate the rate of the constant rate and use for the discovery of other particles like pion actually was discovered in that way. And also, you can learn about the constant rates. So that is the constant rate detectors that we were used. And another example again is bubble chamber. It's actually fairly similar to the cloud chamber. And I think handout I described more detail about how this cloud chamber and the bubble chamber works. And you can actually take a picture of what happened in the bubble chamber, and also you can apply some magnetic field. So this is a nice example of the beautiful picture. And they apply some magnetic field, so you can actually follow the trace of constant rate and try to determine what kind of interaction happened and what kind of secondary particle was generated. So for example, here, they found out that the positron was making a trace in here, and they know it's positron because they know the direction of the magnetic field, and they know which direction the positron will bend and which direction the electron will bend. So that's how they determine this trace as positron trace. And positron meet some kind of material inside this beaker, and it was annihilated and made a gamma, and then gamma was making an electron and a hole pair, and this electron and then positron was bending in the other direction because of the magnetic field. And actually, there's a lot of information that you can gain by looking at this film. For example, this is positron, and this is positron. So it's the same positron, but you can see the trajectory is different. Because this positron is much higher energetic than this positron, then it will bend less in the magnetic field. But this positron is actually much less energetic, so it will lose all of its energy during its following this trajectory and just cease to exist around this point. So by looking at this one, you can actually say the energy of constant rate and the trajectory of constant rates and interactions. So that was bubble chamber. So again, how to make your detector. There's a bunch of things that you can change from the energy loss to the whatever you can measure. So ionization loss, as we talk about, when charged particle come into the material, and when it loses its energy, it will ionize the material, and it will have a plus charge like this. But most of the time, what will happen is it will recombine with electrons inside the material and then neutralize again. But what can happen is if you induce some kind of high voltage around this material, then actually you can gain some kind of signal in here. The electron signal, the positron, the plus will be trying to, it depends on what kind of material that you are using, but if you use like gas, then you will actually go through this electrode and then you can actually collect the charge which was induced by this ionization loss. That's how you can actually measure and build your detector. And also, you can build the Cherenkov radiation, just try to look at the radiation by itself. And because there's more sensitive instrument than our eye, you can try to count how many photons that was created by cosmic rays. That's how we can actually detect the cosmic rays. For example, this one is a nice example. This is scintillation. So what will happen is when charged particle goes through this material, bacteria, it is always, as we always heated by secondary particle of cosmic rays generated by air shower. And it will excite, it will go through this material and lose its energy by ionization loss. And some of the material in this scintillation plate is the name of this material, and will be excited because of this ionization loss. And this material is special because when it is excited and it goes, and after some time, it will try to go back to the stable stage, which is ground stage. During this energy change, it emits some kind of light which is visible for us. That's why you can actually see the faint light in here. It's not like there's someone turning the light on the other side. It's just because the cosmic ray is bumping around this material, and that kind of interaction is happening in this material, so that's why you can see the light. And if you have a UV sensitive instrument or detector which can count how many light was generated by cosmic ray, you can learn about what kind of cosmic ray went through this material. So that is one of the detectors. So I'm sorry that we had to test the time, but this is the last slide. So we talk about the early generation of cosmic ray, which helped us to understand about the cosmic ray, but it's not really accurate enough to tell us about the cosmic ray itself. And we develop our technique about the detection as we understand more about the interaction with the cosmic ray to the matter. Because you understand about the interaction, then you can actually think about what kind of interaction you can actually use to detect the cosmic ray itself. Again, when you want to study about the cosmic ray, there are these three components that you want to measure. First of all, you want to know what kind of cosmic ray it is. You want to know whether it's a proton or a helium or an ion. Meaning you want to measure the charge of cosmic ray. Second, you want to know the energy of cosmic ray. And third, you want to know where it came from, so directional information. So this is one of the example of the most recent detector. Well, the detector itself is 10 years old, but you will launch in this year. It will be fun. So if you go to the Google and try to find the AMS, then you will come up with this webpage, electromagnetic spectrometer, and this is the time until you will launch in Imperial. There can be some delay, so it's not guaranteed to be.
So what size is that detector?
I think it's several meter. I'm sorry, I don't have the exact number, but I think it's less than 5 meters for sure. I think it's maybe 1 meter, 2 meter, that kind of range. So this is the collection of detectors. So up to now, we talk about the bubble chamber, cloud chamber, and emergent chamber. That's only just a single component. But in here, there's like several different kinds of components. Just try to measure more accurately about what is the cosmic ray. And in here, we actually can see how much we've been improving detectors-wise. So, because, for example, the number of channels that we are talking about here is 300,000 number of channels, meaning that there's that much of channel trying to measure the detailed information of cosmic ray when test through. And we have a technique to be able to individually control this much of channel and read individual information of this much of channel. So that's kind of amazing, I think. And before, when you look at the cloud chamber, you need to really look closely because you don't know when it will happen, how it will happen. You need to be very careful and waiting with your camera and take a picture to know. And you need to rely on the resolution of your eye, whether you can recognize the difference between one track and the other track, how well you can determine. If it is separated by 1 meter, we can say it is separated by 1 meter, but if it is separated by 1 millimeter, it will start to be hard. This detector can measure the track of cosmic ray when it is apart by 10 micrometers. So it's really, really detailed accuracy. In a way, it's level of the accuracy the human eye cannot recognize the difference, but this detector can. So that's a spatial resolution of tracker that we have at this moment, and actually this is much better than this detector in this sense, but this is going to the space, so you need to compensate and under it. And the energy resolution of recall energy calorimeter is about 2.5 to 3%. So, and if you look at the picture actually, then you will kind of hate this picture because there's a bunch of letter here, which you don't understand what's well, why his name is KIP. Almost look like the signal between the scientists, but just we are lazy to write down the full name. So in here I try to write down the full name. So TRD is transition radiation detector. So it's a detector which will try to detect the radiation coming from transition radiation that we talk about. And time of flight is the detector which we measure when it hits by quantum rate, then it will record the time and try to measure the time difference between one detector.
Is the orientation of the TOF vertical or horizontal?
It's vertical, so there's one TOF here.
Okay, but the detectors are on the side or behind it?
I think it's.
Oh, really?
It also depends on the
weather. This time of flight depends on distance.
Yes.
And the distance seems to be relatively short if it's a horizontal orientation.
Mm-hmm. No, I think it's vertical. Yes, one TOF with the other. So you measure the time of flight between these detectors, so how fast the cosmic
ray is. I see. They're sandwiched.
Yes,
okay, thank you. Sorry.
And then tracker, so you will measure how it travels. Because this is, there is a magnetic field inside this detector, so you can actually measure the bending of the cosmic ray, and you can estimate about the energy of the cosmic ray. And reimagined Cherenkov is trying to measure the Cherenkov radiation coming from the cosmic ray. Because we are trying to measure kinetic cosmic rays, so it will emit some Cherenkov. And the electron colorimeter, E-color is electron colorimeter, and it's actually trying to measure the energy coming from the secondary particle by artificially inducing the electromagnetic shower that we talk about. So what will happen is positron will bend like that, the electron will bend like that, and you can measure all these directions and then changes of the cosmic ray by measuring, seeing the signal from this individual detector. And for example, the electron is much higher energy than in the bandless. So by looking at the signal coming from these 300,000 channels, you can actually determine when it hits the detector, how it bends into the magnetic field, and then how much energy it actually has. And combining all this information, then you can actually get what kind of cosmic ray pass through the proton detector, and that will give us about the understanding, help us understand about cosmic ray better. So that is the, I will skip this part because we don't have enough time. And also, as you can imagine, because this will go to the space shuttle station, so you need to think about not only just the detection part, how to control the detection part, because there's no power cord to power all these channels. So you need to use solar array to control and power this detector. And you need to think about how to make sure that you will not break down when you bring this enormous detector to the space, and how to communicate with your detector, that sort of stuff. So that's the helpful sub-detectors that will help us to control this detector and try to find out what's going on inside the detector. I'm sorry, it's already 10 minutes past. And so that's what we talked so about the end of this lecture. So we talk about what kind of interaction charge and particle will go through when it meets the matter, and how that will actually happen when it hits the atmosphere, and also how we can use that interaction to detect the atmosphere. So the next lecture will be trying to answer the question about what cosmic ray can tell us about the universe itself. So first of all, we need to answer this question. Actually, follow the other question: what kind of cosmic ray are we seeing at Earth? Because we already know that charged particles will go through all the interaction, which actually can destroy the original cosmic ray by interaction. That means that whatever cosmic ray we are seeing at Earth is already go through all these different kind of interaction from its original side. So what we are measuring in Earth may be different from the original information of cosmic ray. And if we want to understand the original information of cosmic ray, then we need to understand where we are standing from that matter. So that means that we need to understand where we are living in universe-wise point of view. So what is the magnetic field surrounding us? And what kind of matter is surrounding us? So we will talk about that in the next lecture. Thank you for coming.